Hello, I'm Ioannis Dounis. Together with Georgios Kouroussias, we will guide you through Citrix ADC BLX deployment and configuration. Let's quickly see what Citrix ADC BLX is. Citrix ADC BLX is a software version of Citrix ADC running as a set of processes on a Linux system. BLX delivers the rich set of features of Citrix ADC combined with high scalable performance. BLX comes optionally with DBDK support, offering maximum deployment flexibility and resource utilization efficiency. Today, we will examine Citrix ADC BLX in DBDK mode. Let's see the agenda for today's presentation. We will examine basic Linux optimizations, that is, optimizations for the host system of BLX, installing and deploying BLX with DBDK, sample BLX configuration for HTTP load balancing, and finally, testing BLX performance. So let's start with basic Linux host optimizations. These optimizations are optional, but they will guarantee we maximize performance and resource utilization efficiency. We will examine isolating CPUs that will be used by BLX main working processes, making sure that no other processes are scheduled on them by Linux kernel. Next, we will consider the NUMA architecture of our server, maximizing locality for our resources, that is CPUs, network interfaces, and RAM huge pages assigned to BLX. With optimizations done, we will proceed with deploying Citrix ADC BLX with DBDK. We will start by building DBDK library, then configuring example DBDK setup through provided DBDK helper script, that is loading UIOIGP driver into kernel, allocating huge pages, and assigning UIOIGP driver to the network interfaces that we will use with BLX with DBDK. After configuring DBDK, we will proceed with installing BLX and configuring it to use DBDK. BLX in DBDK mode will automatically use assigned network interfaces and any huge pages on system. For our testing, we will deploy a 6-core BLX with DBDK with two Intel XL710 40 Gbps network interfaces for the data plane. So let's proceed with deployment. We will begin our optimizations by selecting the network interfaces that we will dedicate to our BLX with DBDK deployment. Let's examine the status of network interfaces on our server. We will dedicate ENS3F0 and ENS1F0 interfaces to our BLX. Both interfaces are XL710 40 Gbps cards. First step is to identify the NUMA node where its network interface belongs. We can do this by examining a file per network interface in /sys directory. We can see that ENS3F0 belongs to NUMA node 0 and ENS1F0 belongs again to NUMA node 0. Next step is to identify how our server CPUs are distributed in available NUMA nodes. We can do that by examining the output of lscpu command. By observing these two fields, we can see that our server has two NUMA nodes active. CPUs 0 to 23 belong to NUMA node 0, and CPUs 24 to 47 belong to NUMA node 1. For maximum efficiency and locality of network interfaces to CPUs, we will select CPUs to assign and bind our BLX processes that belong to the same NUMA node as our network interfaces, that is, CPUs from this set. As a next step, we will isolate the CPUs that we will use for our BLX deployment from the kernel scheduler. We can do that by using the isol CPUs kernel command line interface option. I have a little script here that uses the Grabby tool to set the ISOL CPU's command line option for all our kernels. For our deployment, we will use 6 CPUs. That is, we will assign these 6 cores for our DLX main worker processes. We will now have to reboot our server for this option to get effect. Now that our server is back, we will need to examine the /proc/cmdline file to see if our option was correctly used by Grab. So our option was correctly configured, and by examining HTOP, we can see that no process is executing on CPUs from 1 to 6. These CPUs are excluded from kernel scheduling. We will continue by configuring DPDK and then installing and configuring BLX with DPDK. First step is to compile for our system. We can easily do this by using the DPDK setup script that is provided by DPDK package. This script is located in user tools directory and it's called dpdksetup.sh. We will need to identify the correct target. So our target is 14 for our system, 64 bits Linux system with GCC. We can give this option here and start the build process. Build is complete. And now we will need to insert the correct module, in our case IGP UIO module. Module was inserted successfully. Set up huge pages according to our system topology. So we will go with 21, and we need to be careful to assign memory on the same NUMA node as our network interfaces for maximum locality. So we will issue 21 option here. The same script is used for the build process and many configuration steps for DPDK. So here we have 2 megabyte huge pages, and we need to set up how many of these huge pages we will use on each NUMA node. Our CPUs and network interfaces are at node 0, so we will use for our setup here 4096 huge pages of 2 megabytes each. This is 8 gigabytes of RAM on node 0, and for node 1, 0 pages, because our resources are node 0. Next step is to bind our selected network interfaces to IGB UIO module. This is option 23. We have already selected our 2 interfaces, so we issue 23. And we can see this summary here. We will go for ENS3F0 that currently uses the Linux kernel driver I40E. We will unbind it from this driver and bind it to IGB UIO DPDK driver here. To do this, we will need to get the PCI slot address here of our network interface and issue it on this prompt here. Okay, and do the same, issue again 23, for our other NIC. We'll go for ENS1F0 here, get the PCI address here, and again give it to this prompt. Our DPDK setup is complete. We can have a summary of huge page mapping here with 28. And also, we can examine the binding of our network interfaces to IGP UIO modules using option 22. We will proceed with installation of BLX and setup to use DPDK. I have already downloaded this BLX archive here. We will extract this. And we can see that we have some RPM packages to install. Installation of BLX is complete. And now we can proceed to configure our BLX parameters like cores used and network details like management IP. we can do this by modifying etcblx.conf file here. This file controls many aspects of PLX deployment and has many useful comments about what its parameter is doing. So our first configuration option is which cores our BLX will be using. This is given by user in this field by specifying a hexadecimal mask here. Each bit represents one CPU of our system. We will be using CPUs 0 to 5. So we will need to specify these options here to use the first 6 cores of our system. Next option that we will be configuring is management IP address of our PLX deployment. We will also use one interface for the management plane. We will create a MAC VLAN interface on our server's management plane interface, ENO1 in our case. This IP will be assigned on this management interface. We can continue by configuring the default gateway for our management plane. This is the basic setup for our BLX. Before starting BLX, we will need to make sure that the MAC VLAN interface for our BLX management plane does not have GRO and GSO NIC offloading features enabled, as this is not supported by BLX. So we're using if tool minus K, we can disable these options. Next step is to start our BLX process by using systemd. BLX runs as a service on our system by default. Now we are ready to proceed with configuring our BLX with TPDK for simple HTTP load balancing and observe the great performance BLX provides on our Linux setup.
Our setup is now ready for use. We have to connect on it in order to enable the load balancing feature, add the appropriate networking configuration, create some load balancers and the corresponding service groups, and after that, we also need to bind the appropriate backend server IPs to the corresponding service groups. Finally, we need to bind our load balancers with our service groups. Let's proceed with the demo. We have connected on BLX and now we are going to verify that the Citrix ADC flavor is the one that we want. After that, we are going to verify that the NSIP is the one that we gave initially. Now, we are going to see the available interfaces. As we can see, we have two 40G interfaces. We are going to use them in order to communicate with our traffic generators. Now, let's enable the load balancing feature. After that, let's add the appropriate VLANs, NSIPs, and subnets to the appropriate data interfaces in order to be able to communicate with our traffic generators. Now, let's do the same for the second interface. We can verify our changes by providing the command showVLAN. Now, let's create the appropriate LBV servers that we need. Add the first LBV server and the second LBV server. The protocol is HTTP. The port is 80 and the load balancing method that we are going to use is round robin. Now, let's create the two service groups that we need. Now, let's bind the backend server's IPs to our service groups. We are going to use 100 backend server IPs for each service group. Finally, let's bind our LBV servers with the service groups. We can verify our changes by providing the command show LBV server. As we can see, we have two available load balancing vServers. The state of them is down. We need to enable our backend services in order to be able to send traffic to those LBV servers. Now we are going to execute an HTTP throughput test. For this test, we are going to use 100 kilobyte objects. The clients open multiple TCP connections and keep them open. By using those connections, they send multiple GET requests. On the backend side, the TCP connections are also persistent. In the following demo, we are going to enable the backend services, start the traffic, and after that, we are going to evaluate the performance of BLX. We are back at our console. Now, we are going to execute an HTTP throughput performance test. For this test, we are going to use 100 kilobyte object sizes. First of all, let's see the state of our LBV servers. The state of our LBV servers is now down. We need to enable our backend services in order to see the new state. Let's do so. Our backend servers are now up. As we can see, our virtual servers are up too. Now, they can accept traffic. The next step is to start our clients. The traffic is going up. As we can see from the console, each of those LBV servers can handle close to 46k requests per second. Let's check some other stats too. First of all, let's check the total amount of throughput in the system. This is close to 80G. Now, let's see the CPU utilization on the system. The average CPU utilization is close to 95%. We can also see the CPU utilization for each packet engine by providing the command start CPU. Finally, let's see the total amount of HTTP requests and responses in the system. This number is close to 90K requests or responses per second. So, by using BLX with only 6 packet engines and 2 40G data NICs, we can get close to 80G of HTTP throughput.